Hey everybody, my name is Deja and welcome back to my channel. Today I am going to be going over all the books that I read in November and December. I read a lot of books and I filmed a November wrap-up, but by the time that I was going to get around to editing it, it would have been so late in the month that I just decided to combine November and December together. And I read a lot of amazing books, but I also had some duds that we will definitely talk about. Today I'm going to be doing my wrap-up in the format that my friend Jan does her wrap-ups, and that is reread, rewrite, burn tag. And so basically all the books that I read for the 2 months, which is a total of 48, but there's 47 in here because two books are in a series and it's a graphic novel series. So I just decided to put them on the same little pieces of paper and I put them into this cute little smiley face mug that my sister got me. I'm gonna pull out three of them and then tell you which one I would reread, which one I would rewrite, and which one I would burn. I feel like this is going to be a quicker way to do this wrap up because there are so many books to talk about. I cannot give in-depth 3, 4, 5 minute reviews for each book because it's just not feasible. It'll be so long. So I'm gonna try and stick to a minute and a half for each book and my reasoning for each one. But before we get into the actual tag, I'm gonna be going over my stats for both months. So let me actually move over here so I can pop in the pictures. So in November, I read 20 books. 8 of those were by POC authors. I had no rereads and no DNFs, and I read 5,911 pages. The most I ever read in a month is 20 books, and the only other time that I did that was earlier this year, I believe in May. So I was really surprised that I was able to read so much, especially because November was quite a busy month for me. For my genre breakdown, I read 4 fantasy, 3 horror, 2 literary fiction, 1 mystery, 6 romance, and 4 thrillers. And then for format read, I read 9 audiobooks, 4 ebooks, 1 physical book, and 6 that were hybrid, which is a mixture of audio with either ebook or physical. For audience, I read 18 adult books and 2 middle grade books. For ratings, I had 1 2-star, 1 2.5-star, 2 3-stars, 4 3.5-stars, 4 4-stars, 3 4.5-stars, and 5 5-stars. And I read 14 novels, 3 novellas, and 3 graphic novels / manga. Then for author status, 4 of them were debut, 7 were new to me, and 9 were repeat authors. And in December, I read 18 books, 4 which were by POC authors, no rereads, no DNFs. I read 4,238 pages. I read 1 fantasy, 1 historical, 6 horror, 2 mystery, 4 romance, and 4 thriller. Then for format, I had 9 audiobooks, 3 ebooks, no physical books, and 6 that were hybrid. I read 17 adult books and 1 young adult book. For ratings, I had 3 2-stars, which is kind of a lot of 2-stars for me. 4 3-stars, 1 3.5-star, 5 4-stars, and 5 4.5-stars, no 5-stars for me that month. I read 10 novels, 8 novellas, and then for author status, I had 1 debut author, 11 new to me authors, and 6 repeat authors. That's a lot of stats. You guys can kind of take that in. I filmed technically 2 reading vlogs throughout the course of these months, but I was aiming to film 3. I was going to be doing a reading vlog where I read some of the Goodreads Choice Awards nominees, but that reading vlog just did not pan out. So a lot of these books I was reading for that reading vlog, but I also filmed 2 other reading vlogs, a Christmas romance reading vlog and a Christmas horror reading vlog, horror and thriller, I should say. So I will have those linked up in the cards above if you want to check those out to see kind of like more of my thoughts on some of these books. So now moving back to the middle, I put all these on the table, mixed them up, and put them back in the jar. So I'm just gonna pick from the top. So the very first 3 that we have, oh, I forgot I taped these closed. Okay, the very first one that we have is Vera Wang's Unsolicited Advice for Murderers. Then we have Not So Perfect Strangers, 2 of books that I really enjoyed. And then the last one that I have is Wayward. I really enjoyed all these books. I gave Not So Perfect Strangers 5-stars, and then I gave the other 2 books 4.5-stars. So I really enjoyed all of them. My least favorite of them all, though, is Wayward, just because this one is historical fiction. So I'm gonna burn this one. We follow a woman, and she is escaping from an abusive situation. So she retreats to this cottage that was owned by one of the women in her family, and it was kind of like passed down onto her. And we follow her perspective as well as 2 other perspectives of her past ancestors as they are going through different women's issues and facing different things, because they all are facing men treating them terribly. They're all facing misogyny. They're all facing all these things in different time periods and in different ways. And so it's just kind of like reflecting on the different ways that women are experiencing oppression. So I really enjoyed that one. I'm gonna have to burn it. Then Vera Wang's Unsolicited Advice for Murderers, I'm going to rewrite, I guess. I don't know what I would rewrite in it. I think maybe just adding in more cute scenes, but there was a ton in this book. And I really enjoyed the murderer who's revealed in the end. We follow Vera Wang and she owns a tea shop. And one day when she comes down in the morning, she finds a man dead in the middle of her tea shop. So she calls the police and everything, but they are talking that it's not a homicide. She believes that it's a homicide because she watches a lot of crime shows. So she takes it upon herself to basically investigate the murder. And that leads her into connection with a lot of different members of the family and people related to him that he knows, and they all kind of connect. And Vera Wang is a Chinese mother, and I loved seeing that representation. She's like a 56-year-old Chinese woman, and I just really enjoyed her character so much and how she interacted with all the other characters. So I don't know what I would rewrite, but maybe just adding in more cute scenes between the characters. And then the last one, in Not So Perfect Strangers, I gave 5 stars. This follows a black woman and she's escaping from an abusive relationship. So she decides to go off, and her son she brings with her, who's 18 years old, but he decides that he does not want that. He misses his family and his friends and his dad. So he decides to go back. And because of this, she also goes back because she doesn't want to leave her son alone with a monster. But when she is on her way back to her own personal hell, a woman begins pounding on the door of her car, and she's also escaping from a marriage as well, but for a very different reason. This explores a lot of the differences between black women and white women and the ways that they face different issues. And this is kind of like a Strangers on the Train situation where two people meet and they're like, I'll kill for you if you'll kill for me. And it's kind of like that, not completely, but one of them wants it to be that kind of situation. And it was just very interesting. I enjoyed it a lot. It's a really, really amazing domestic thriller. We're going to move on to our next 3 picks, just picking off the top here. So the very first one is, if I could open it, Midnight is the Darkest Hour, which is on my honorable mentions of the year. The second one is The Christmas Guest, which I also really enjoyed. Hopefully this is one that I did not like. And I have Pen Pal. Okay, so Pen Pal I'm going to be burning. This one was extremely disappointing for me. It was on my disappointing books of the year. So we follow a man and he's like looking back on the past of these memories and kind of noticing some weird trends related potentially to this pen pal that he got when he was a child. And I feel like this book went nowhere. I didn't know anything more than I knew at the beginning of the story. It drug on way too long. It was really, really amazing at creating a creepy vibe and this just tension, but I feel like the story went nowhere and it had no plot. It was just all vibes, no plot, which okay is fine sometimes, but for that to work for me, I generally need to be attached to the character, and this character I feel like was very lackluster and didn't have much depth or nuance, so I just wasn't vibing with it. Then Midnight is the Darkest Hour I'm actually gonna rewrite, even though it's in my favorites of the year, because me and Haley did a live show with Ashley Winstead over on our Patreons for this book, and she actually told us an alternate ending for this story, and I feel like I would have loved it even more if she did this alternate ending instead, and it definitely would have been like up there, and that kind of swayed me into putting it into my honorable mentions. I feel like without that ending it wouldn't be in my honorable mentions, but I had to put it there because of this ending that she was discussing with us, and so I would rewrite it to have that ending. Midnight is the Darkest Hour basically follows a preacher's daughter and a boy from the wrong side of the tracks in this very small religious community in the deep south, and they are starting to unearth skeletons from the swamp, and these two are actually very close friends, and they committed a murder a while back, and they are worried that there is a copycat killer or somebody knows that what they actually did that one night. So it is really good, but it's very romance heavy. So I know some people have been liking it despite the romance, even if they don't like romance and thrillers, but I really enjoyed that aspect. And then The Christmas Guest I thought was a perfect little holiday thriller. We follow an art student and she basically has nowhere else to go for Christmas, and she is American but she's in England, and she gets invited back by one of her classmates to basically be with her and her family for Christmas. And I will just say there's more sinister plans of why the invitation was given to her. So yeah, it was really good and just super Christmassy, super atmospheric. I really enjoyed it. Moving on to the next 3. First up we have One Bloody Thing After Another. Then we have The Lover, And lastly, Dark Roads by Chevy Stevens. Okay, let me see. Okay, Dark Roads by Chevy Stevens. I'm going to burn this book because I gave it 2 stars. It was just very boring and very long. This one follows our main character, and she is orphaned after her father passes away. So she's taken in by her aunt, and her aunt is married to this police officer who kind of really wants to control our main character's life. And there's also this road running adjacent to this town where women go missing. And so she actually ends up running away, and people believe that she goes missing. And we get another perspective of another girl who's coming into the town to try and figure out what happened to her sister. It was really long, and I know the author was talking about in the author's note how she really wanted to focus on missing and murdered indigenous women, and she barely focused on indigenous culture at all. And I think that she really didn't address the issue of missing and murdered indigenous women. I saw little references to the indigenous culture, but she didn't specifically talk about missing and murdered indigenous women as an issue, which I wish she would have done, but I wouldn't rewrite it. Then One Bloody Thing After Another. This book, I really cannot even describe it. This one was a fever dream for me, and I feel like it was just a little messy. So that's why I would rewrite it, just to be cleaner and like so I could get more from the story, because I feel like I didn't really understand what was going on. And so I wish that it was just more clear, but I did enjoy what I did get. Like, it was an enjoyable reading experience, but I still just can't really describe it or really know what was going on throughout the story because it was just so fever dreamy. And then the last one is The Lover, which is super duper short, and it is on KU, and it's also on Audible. It's an Audible exclusive, so you can only get the audiobook from Audible, but if you download it from KU, you can add the audio for free. Sometimes they do that with KU. And this one just follows a woman as she is looking for love in this kind of like small cove of a town, and there's a forest nearby, and she may or may not find this love like in the forest. It was so good and just dark and had like this fairy tale kind of atmosphere that I really enjoyed. Moving on to the next three. I don't think I said The Lover I am rereading, and the other one I'm rewriting. I don't think I said that, but here are the next three picks. So first we have Mame, and then we have Practice Makes Perfect. And then lastly, we have Love Light Farms. Okay, so Practice Makes Perfect by Sarah Adams, I'm going to burn. This is one of my least favorite books of the year because it just felt so fake. It just felt so fake. It follows a floral arrangist. I don't know what you would call her, but she's a floral arranger, I guess. And she is in love with this bodyguard in this small little town. And I thought that I would really like it because I was anticipating the first book in this series so much, which I still haven't read, and I probably won't, because I just did not enjoy the characterization in this book, and I didn't enjoy that it was closed door. I feel like the characters in this, they were very much giving pick-me energy, and it's very much a privilege, some of the things that the main character was complaining about, and I feel like she didn't recognize that, and I don't think people would understand that those are privileges, if that makes sense. So the author is probably very much unaware. Like, the main character in this, she is seen as very innocent, and she hates that because she's a grown woman, which is completely fair to feel hurt by that. But at the same time, a lot of like black girls and girls of color are sexualized at very young ages by society, by men, by everybody. And so that is an institutional issue that is real. And I'm not saying what she's going through is not real, but at the same time, it's a privilege to have those things. That doesn't mean that they're not annoying or that you can't be hurt, but I think you also need to recognize the privilege that you have, if that makes sense. But again, I feel like that's something that not a lot of white people would think about. So here, I'm making y'all aware now that black women and black girls and girls of color are sexualized at a very young age, and it's a privilege to not face that. And then I'm going to rewrite Mame. I enjoyed Mame a lot because we follow a Ghanaian woman, and she, I think, is Ghanaian but lives in England. Like, she was not from Ghana, but her parents are from Ghana, and she takes care of her father, but she feels like that's kind of her whole life. So when her mother moves back from Ghana to take care of the father herself, she moves out and begins to start a new life. And I really enjoyed kind of like the family dynamics in this. I enjoyed the exploration and the commentary, but I feel like this book was kind of plotless. So I would rewrite it to be more plot filled and have a little bit more something to it. And then Love Light Farms, I would reread. This one is super cute. This one takes place on a Christmas tree farm, and there is our main character. She runs this Christmas tree farm, and it's kind of going under a little bit. So she decides to enter entered to this competition being hosted by a social media influencer who is going to like give money to a business whoever wins. So she makes up this story that she runs the business with her boyfriend, but she actually doesn't have a boyfriend. So she ends up having to fake date with one of her best friends to get this money. And it was just so good, so cute. It's very much more like holiday-y than Christmassy, if that makes sense. Like, it takes place over fall, October, with Halloween, Thanksgiving, and right up until Christmas. So I would definitely reread it again around that time of year. Then I'm pulling three out. I know you can't see, but I'm pulling three out. I accidentally pulled four. So here is the next three options. And I have Flagrant, which is by Alexandria House. I have Disco Death Trap. And lastly, we have Christmas Presents by Lisa Unger. Okay, so I am going to burn Flagrant. This one is just a basic little basketball romance, but it has so much cheating in it. And cheating doesn't always bother me in this book. And I feel like in the end, the character, you may say, gets his comeuppance. I guess you could say that, for cheating. But at the same time, I feel like the way he gets his comeuppance is very out of character for the female character to have done for him to kind of get payback, if that makes sense. So I didn't really enjoy that, and I didn't enjoy his character. I feel like at least if you're gonna make him a cheater, make him likable so I can at least be charmed by him, liked by him. But I didn't see why the main character was with him at all. Like, I don't understand why the female character even had an interest in him besides he had money and he was a basketball player. That's it. Then Christmas Presents by Lisa Unger, I would rewrite, but I really enjoyed that one a lot, and I think it's one of the best other Christmas thrillers that I've read. I think I've only read a couple, but out of like horror and thriller, it's one of the best ones that I've read. This one is in a small town again, and it follows a woman who just runs like a little bookstore, but she's connected to this killer who has been locked up in prison, but then a true crime podcaster slash author comes in claiming that there is kind of like some other killings going on that resemble this one, so it's kind of giving copycat killer, but they're unsure if they actually locked up the right guy because it could be the original killer. They are thinking it could be that, or that it could be a copycat killer, so they don't really know, and they're beginning to investigate and dig in, which is kind of traumatizing to our main character. I really enjoyed this one. I would just rewrite it to be Christmassy. I enjoyed the characterization. I enjoyed where the plot went. I didn't guess the plot twist, and I just thought it was overall a really good little Christmassy read. And then Disco Death Trap, I would reread. This one actually takes place on New Year's Eve, so I would definitely reread it again for a New Year's Eve kind of vibe, because I've never read another book that takes place on New Year's Eve. And there is a group of students who are going to the roller rink in 1980 for a lock-in over New Year's Eve. And while they're there, killing starts to begin right as the hand strikes midnight. So this one is a very simple slasher. It's not my favorite slasher that I've ever read because I feel like I would want them to have more commentary, but I really, really loved who the killer was in the end and everything that had to do with that. I thought that was done extremely well, and I thought the slashing and the gore was done really well as well. I really enjoyed this one overall. Next up, we're pulling three more. I feel like this is going by faster, but also slower at the same time, so I have no idea. Then the very first one is Dying for Christmas by, I think, Tammy Cohen. Then I have None of This is True by Lisa Jewell. And then lastly, I have Killjoy by Holly Jackson. So Dying for Christmas, I would burn. I gave that one 2 stars. It just was not a good book at all. I did not enjoy it. It's supposed to be like a Christmas thriller, which is fine. And this woman basically gets kidnapped by this man, and he's giving her something every day of the 12 days of Christmas after Christmas. But I feel like, again, it really wasn't that Christmassy because it took place after Christmas, which is why I read it in the first place. But then also on the same page, I wanted it to be like he's giving these 12 horrible gifts, and like in the end she's gonna die, but like something happens. Like, I don't know what I wanted to happen, but the actual portion of the book where he's giving her these gifts is a really small percentage, and the rest of it is kind of just nonsense that I did not enjoy. So I wish that it just like didn't exist, honestly. And then None of This Is True by Lisa Jewell, I would rewrite. I don't know what I would rewrite particularly, but me and Lisa Jewell do not normally agree. So I would probably just rewrite it to not and be in Lisa Jewell's voice. I wish it was in somebody else's voice because I just don't really enjoy her writing. But we follow a woman and she is at a dinner for her 40th birthday and she realizes that somebody else is also turning 40. These two begin to connect and one of them has a podcast where she hosts women that she think have gone through big issues and can really talk about something. And so the other woman is like, hey, I think I could be a good person to have on this podcast. And she starts to wiggle her way and worm her way into this other woman's life. I really enjoyed the direction that this story went and it took. I really enjoyed the ending. But again, I'm just not a fan of Lisa Jewell's voice. And then lastly, Killjoy by Holly Jackson, I would reread. This one is the prequel to the A Good Girl's Guide to Murder series by this author, and I love this one. We're back in this world with Pip, and this is a prequel, so we are following a murder mystery game that the characters are playing before the events of the first book, and we kind of see her kind of beginning to form this idea of what she's gonna do in the first book. And I just enjoyed that it was like this murder mystery game and it felt like fun. Like it felt like I was playing this game with my friends and trying to figure out who did this. And like it really made me want to host like my own kind of like clue night where we like all dress up and like have a murder mystery night. I think that would be so fun. But like it just felt like I was already doing that with my friends because I just love the characters so much. And then we're pulling another three. You guys should see the pile of just sticky notes on my computer. So the very first one is Sorrowland by River Solomon. Then I have Yellowface by R.F. Kuang. And lastly, we have Mangoes and Mistletoe. Ooh, this one's kind of hard. I don't know because I enjoyed all of these. I guess I'm just going to go by rating. So Sorrowland was my lowest rated book. I gave it 3.5 stars. I enjoyed it. We follow a woman and she is escaping from this commune of weird religious people. And she's pregnant with twins and she gives birth in the woods. And like there's also kind of like some sciencey stuff woven into this story. It's fungal fiction. It has to do with fungus. My friend sent this to me. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to burn it because... Okay, hear me out. The only reason that this one was not higher rated for me was because of the ending and where it went. I don't mind like a sciencey twist, but usually I like to know that from the beginning. I don't normally like it as a twist, and this one kind of had some twist in it that I didn't really enjoy, like the direction that they're going into. It kind of reminded me of When No One Is Watching by Alyssa Cole with where it went, and it was kind of like action-y as well, and I don't really enjoy those kind of like action vibes unless it's like fantasy, and then even then I'm like, okay, I just don't enjoy action scenes that much. And I feel like this book kind of went more action-y. And then I would rewrite Mangoes and Mistletoe. This one is another cute little holiday romance that I read for the reading vlog that I read Christmas romances, and this one was super fun. This one follows a baking competition and there's a Dominican woman who enters into the competition. She's our main character and she ends up getting paired with another Dominican woman in this competition, and it's kind of like Grumpy Sunshine, and it's really cute, really good. I would just rewrite it to be longer and have more character development in it because I didn't feel super attached to the characters, which I wish I did. So I wish it was just longer and we had more baking in it. We didn't have much baking, so I would just add in more baking scenes and I would add in just some more character development to make it a bit longer and more fleshed out. And then lastly, I would reread Yellowface by R.F. Kuang. I think that this book needs to be read. I love it so much. It's about a woman and she is kind of like a down on her luck writer. She has not really been successful with writing, but she has this friend who has been extremely successful. And then they end up hanging out together one day and the woman who's successful ends up passing away right in front of our main character. And our main character is like, okay, snooping around a little bit and finds a manuscript and decides to take the manuscript and rewrite it to be her own. The problem here is that the woman who passed away, who's extremely successful, is Asian and she writes stories about the Asian experience. So this book, that's this manuscript, is about Chinese immigrants and their labor and stuff like that. So our main character ends up writing it and committing Yellowface by getting an ambiguous name, by kind of taking an ambiguous looking picture where nobody really knows her race and people assume that she's even Asian, but she's white. And she took this story, redoctored it and made it her own and published it under her own name and became extremely successful. So that is very problematic, of course, and being in her head was insufferable because she is a terrible character, but like it was meant to be insufferable and it was meant to be that way. So I really kind of enjoyed it being so insufferable because the character work was there. I can dislike characters. I just need it to actually be cohesive, and I need the characters to have a lot of depth and nuance to them, even if I don't like them. Moving on to the next three, we are starting to get down there. We are starting to get down. So this very first one is Every Heart a Doorway by Shauna McGuire. Then I have The 7-Year Slip by Ashley Pawson. Oh no, what's this last one gonna be? Dear Laura. Okay, I can work with that. Dear Laura, I'm going to burn. This one was just okay for me. This one is about a girl and her friend disappears right in front of her eyes one day and he's never seen again. She starts getting these letters that show up on her door with her name and basically telling her that if she gives this mysterious person, specifically a man, these things, that she will get a clue about where her friend's body is. It's about this girl dealing with grief and trying to like find closure, but at the same time I wish that it was just fleshed out more and we had a little bit more of those themes and a little bit more plot, because I feel like for being so short it was just a little like something was just a little off. I don't know. And then Every Heart a Doorway I would rewrite. I don't know what I would write about this one because honestly, to me, it is a perfect fantasy for me. But The 7-Year Slip was on my favorites of the year. Like, I love her, so I have to rewrite this one. And so Every Heart a Doorway follows a girl, Nancy, and she is going to Eleanor West's home for wayward children, which is a home that is for children. When they go through these portals, that they're like door portals to these other worlds, they come back and they're really not the same because they went through these portals to these magical realms, these magical worlds, and they usually really enjoy it and they have a good time and they feel like they found a home and found a place to fit in. So Eleanor West's home is kind of like a rehabilitation center for these children, and we follow Nancy as she has come back from this world and she goes to Eleanor West's home. And there's actually a murder mystery element in this. I never hear anybody talk about that, but I love that element so much that I feel like I really want to talk about that. And it made me love it so much. It's just like this cozy little fantasy with like found family and a murder mystery element. And I'm really excited to continue on in the series because I heard in the rest of the series, as you read, it kind of alternates where like every odd book takes place in Eleanor West's home and then every even book takes place in one of these other worlds. So I'm really excited to see like in the next book these other worlds and get more of that fantasy vibe. And then The 7-Year Slip by Ashley Pawson is one of my favorite books of the year. I loved it. It was definitely my favorite romance. This one is very grief heavy because our main character, she just lost her aunt due to suicide and she was very close with her aunt, and she actually inherits this apartment from her aunt. And when she shows up there, there's a man staying there and like, hey, your aunt said I could stay here, whatever, whatever. But turns out that man's actually 7 years in the past and she is 7 years in the future, I guess present, but he's 7 years in the past. And this apartment kind of has some weird time travel capabilities. And he is like a little chef and he's just like trying to make his way. And our main character works in publishing. And so I love seeing publishing and I love seeing like the chef vibes. I loved that. And she actually does find him current day. And he is very different. I enjoyed this one so much. Like, I can't even describe it. I don't know why, but at the end, I was literally tearing up because it had that deeper element with the grief. It had this magical realism element, which I really enjoyed. And I really enjoyed the characters. I thought they had amazing chemistry. And Ashley Pawson just really knows how to write a relationship. And I think that's the foundation of romance. I don't think people appreciate romance enough. But to write a good romance, you have to have good writing capabilities. I think writing a believable, convincible love story that will move people, that will bring people to tears, that people will read thick books over, takes talent. And I just think that Ashley Pawson is really an amazing writer. Pulling next three. We only have a couple more rounds. So this first one is Just Like Home by Sarah Gailey. Then I have, oh, it's ripping, Ice Planet Barbarians by Ruby Dixon. And lastly, we have Snowball Okay, so I'm actually going to burn Snowball. I did really enjoy this one. I would recommend it for the holiday season, but it wasn't like an absolute fave. It's basically just a book about an evil elf on the shelf. That's all you really need to know. It was pretty good. It wasn't like the best thing I've ever read. It's really short, but if you're looking for something that is horror for Christmas season and you think the idea of a elf on the shelf that's evil sounds interesting, I would pick it up, but I have to burn her, unfortunately. I think I'm gonna rewrite Ice Planet Barbarians. I don't know what I would rewrite about it. Maybe like less traveling around, but there was a lot of traveling. I really enjoyed this one though. It basically is about these women who are kidnapped by these aliens, and so they end up crash landing, I believe, and they escape from these other aliens, but they are now all on their own. And so our main character ventures out and finds this other alien creature who believes that they are mated. It is really good. I really enjoyed it, and it was such like a good little romance time that was just like a little alien romance. And honestly, I would recommend it for the winter because it's Ice Planet Barbarians. They're literally on an ice planet. It talks about being cold all the time. But this one had a lot of like survival elements in it, and like I enjoyed that. But at the same time, like I kind of want to continue on in this series to see more of like the actual culture of the aliens themselves and less of like the survival kind of stuff. And then just like Home by Sarah Gailey is like the first real haunted house book that I've enjoyed. I would describe this one as a haunted house. It is different than a haunted house, but at the same time, it is a haunted house. So I don't know. If you don't like haunted houses, you might like it. If you do like haunted houses, you might like it, because I don't like haunted houses and I enjoyed it. So we follow a woman and she gets called back by her mother because her mother is on her deathbed. So she ends up going back to this house where her serial killer father used to live. It's her childhood home, and as I said, she had a serial killer father. So she's kind of reflecting on the past with her dad, and we're seeing a lot of the past. We're seeing kind of like how he nurtured our main character and how he didn't appear as a serial killer, but then also maybe the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree, if you know what I'm saying. But then we're also following present day, and our main character is kind of mad because there is this man from a family that she doesn't like who is like an artist who paints haunted places, and her mother believes that the house is haunted by the victims and stuff like that, so he's there. But it's really good. The house plays a big part in this story. It was its own character, and I think that Sarah Gailey did that amazingly. Okay, we're moving on to the next three. I think I only have a couple more in here. So next up is Make a Scene by Mimi Grace. Then we have Wreck the Halls by Tessa Bailey. And lastly, and then we have Dark Corners by Megan Golden. Okay, so Wreck the Halls, I am going to burn. This one was also in my romance reading vlog where I read Christmas romances. And this one was just like okay for me. It wasn't very Christmassy to me. We followed two characters, and they are the children of this famous like rock band, and they kind of have known each other a little bit, but they get offered this proposition to basically do this reality TV show where they try to get their two moms back together to perform for this like jingle ball type event. And the two women hate each other, so they are on a quest. Okay, I enjoyed the reality TV show elements, but I didn't feel any connection between the characters. I didn't really feel attached to the characters at all, which for me is a really big thing in a romance. And then also, again, it wasn't that Christmassy, so I was like, okay. But I did enjoy the moms. The moms ate, okay? The moms definitely ate. And then Dark Corners, I would rewrite because this one is a little bit different than the first book in the series. This is the second book in the series. This one, basically in the first one, we follow Rachel Kroll, and she is a true crime podcaster who is basically drawn to this town to cover this rape case that is happening in the town. And this one follows her as she is going over this case of a missing influencer and her kind of like wiggling her way into the influencer lifestyle. And this one I enjoyed, but it just didn't enjoy it as much as the first one. I don't know why. I just wish that it had more of like that addictive element that the first one had, because this one didn't have that for me. So I would kind of like rewrite it to have more of just like that addictive element and maybe make it a little bit darker, because it really wasn't dark. And that's what I enjoyed about the first one, is kind of like the darkness and the nuanced conversations that they were having about rape and sexual assault. And this one, I feel like it tried to have nuanced conversations about influencing and influencers, but it didn't go deep enough. It didn't go dark enough for me, and I wish it did. And then Make a Scene by Mimi Grace, I really, really loved, and I would reread it. We follow a baker, and she owns a little baking shop, and outside they have these parking spaces, but the employee parking is for all of the shops that are there, and there's kind of like a hierarchy of who gets what based on how long that they've been there. But the people who move in next door and are running a boxing gym basically begin parking in her employee spots. So she goes over to them and is like, hey, y'all can't park in my spots. But then this man is really fine. Like, the man who runs the shop is really, really fine. And she actually ran into him previously. But she then propositions him, like, hey, y'all can have the parking spaces if you fake date me, because my ex is getting married to one of my relatives and I need someone to go with me to like all of the wedding events. And so she's like, y'all can have the parking spaces if you fake date me. And it's just super cute, super good. I really love it, and I love Mimi Grace's writing. So I think we have two more pairs, or I guess triples. I don't know what you call a pair that's three. I have Candy Cane Kills, a triplet. I don't know. Garlic and the Witch and Garlic and the Vampire. Garlic and the Vampire is the first one. And then Krampus. So I think I'm going to reread Garlic and the Witch and Garlic and the Vampire. This is a middle grade graphic novel series that basically follows this little bulb of garlic. And garlic is a bulb, as I said, but it's a fruit veggie people. There's fruit and veggie people in this book because the witch in the series basically made them to help her garden. And so in the first one, Garlic and the Vampire, they see smoke coming out of this castle and they assume that it is a vampire and that it has really terrible intentions. So they send Garlic off, because she's garlic, to basically talk to the vampire and see what he wants. It's so cute, so good. I love the art style, and I think it's perfect for like the springtime. It's just so cozy, and I loved it. And then I would rewrite Candy Cane Kills. I don't know what I would rewrite actually in this one at all, because it was really fun. We basically just follow a family as they are going to this cabin for Christmas, and the history of that little cabin is intense, where basically there was a massacre of a family in that little cabin. And they also find a VHS tape. This is the second book in a VHS tape series. It's not like official. It's like one of those ones that like is all these different authors writing books. So it's like in a series but not. But there is a VHS tape element in here that I loved. And this one is actually like creepy children. So if you want a creepy child story that's Christmassy, that has a VHS tape element, I would really recommend this one. But also talks about the dynamics of family. And it had disability rep in it. It had queer rep in it. So it was just really good. And I don't know what I would rewrite, but I would have to rewrite something. And then lastly, Krampus, I would burn, because I enjoyed Krampus, but it wasn't my favorite. We follow a musician who is kind of down on his luck, and he literally sees this creature chasing a man in a red suit, aka Santa, up into the sky, and then his red sack falls and lands, and this man gets the red sack. And it kind of leads him into the arms of Krampus, who does not like Santa very much at all. He low-key, they beefin'. It was just okay. I don't think I enjoy men's perspectives that much. I think that I can enjoy them. Like, for example, I love S.A. Cosby's books, and he writes all male perspectives, but it has to be done in a certain way. And this one, the character was just okay. And if you're gonna have a just okay character, why would it be a man? And then also, it was really long. It was just a really, really long. So here is our last little ones, and then I have one extra one in here. So I have All I Want by Alexandria House again. And then I have The Arrangement by Kirsten Modlin. And then lastly, I have One Day in December. Okay, The Arrangement by Kirsten Modlin, I'm going to reread. Okay, I gave it 5 stars or 4.5 stars. I really enjoyed this one a lot. This one is about a couple who are having some marital troubles. So they decide to make this arrangement where they can go on dates with other people on certain days of the week and they can't tell each other anything. But then twists start to happen, okay? This one is pretty short, but this one is twist after twist after twist. I really enjoyed this one a lot. And it reminded me a lot of The Perfect Marriage, with like how many twists it had in it and how it had this kind of like domestic element. I did enjoy The Perfect Marriage more, but The Arrangement is also a good like silly goofy time. If you're just looking for something that's gonna have you gagged, it's gonna pull you out of a reading slump, that is gonna be one of the ones that do that. And then I would rewrite All I Want by That one was just okay for me. I enjoy a second chance romance, and this one was like Christmassy. I enjoyed like the Christmas family vibes of this one, but it had a mental health element to it that I just could not like justify. I don't know, like I feel like if you're doing a short story like this, I feel like adding in a mental health element like that was really dicey, and I feel like not that it was handled improperly, but it needed to have more to it, if that makes sense. So I would just rewrite it to be longer and to like handle the mental health element really well. And then lastly, one day in December, I would burn, because this one is just white people doing white people shit. Basically, it's about a woman who sees a man through the window of a bus. Like, she's inside the bus, he's outside, she sees him through the window, and she instantly falls in love with him. So she's looking for him, keeping her eyes out peeled, and then all of a sudden one day her friend shows up to like this holiday party with a new beau. But then all of a sudden her friend shows up to this party with a new boo, and it's literally that man. And it follows them over the course of 10 years, I think it is, as these two people are kind of, their lives are intertwining, they're unintertwining, they're intertwining again, and just like their kind of story. And then the last one that I have, I'm just gonna like tell y'all about it and what I would do. Killing Stalking, I would reread, of course. Killing Stalking is a manhwa that basically follows this boy. He's a man, but he's a boy that has a crush on this other man, and he's known him for a very long time. He's seen him throughout their like lives. They've been in school together for a little bit, they were in the army together for a little bit, and he stalks him. So he ends up figuring out the code to get into his apartment, and goes into his apartment or his house, and finds a woman there tied up. And right as he finds this woman, the guy that he has a crush on comes back, knocks him out, and when he wakes up, he's like, hey, like, I know you kind of have this woman kidnapped and whatever, and you're like doing crazy stuff that I don't really know what you're doing, but I really like you and I've been stalking you. And the other guy takes him as his sex slave. It's crazy, but it's really good. And if you can handle like extreme horror kind of stuff, I would recommend it, especially if you like romances that are darker, kind of have some morally gray characters. I think you would enjoy this one a lot. So those are all the books that I read in the past 2 months. I hope that you guys enjoyed this video. If you made it to the end, leave a little smiley face emoji for my smiley face mug, and I will see y'all in my next one. Bye, everybody.